here this week. I so much appreciated the opportunity to be given to speak and minister the word here at Ocean Grove. What a tradition that we have here on the picture that you see behind you. As I was reading, it's always been a tradition, even on these premises right here, since, I don't know, about 1876, I think, for this dynamic, if I remember right, about having this song and the phrase, "God be with you till we meet again." And a tremendous thing. You know, I've learned in this visit to Ocean Grove, when I'm up here often during the course of summer, I'm not that far away, as you know, and to realize so many hymns that were written on these grounds here on Ocean Grove. What a history. Great is thy faithfulness. I mean, that's one of the top 10 of the Christian charts. You know, Amazing Grace and How Great Thou Art, and Great is thy faithfulness. Those are some of the biggest hymns. And my favorite hymn is When We All Get to Heaven. And here I find out that, you know, it's written around these premises too. I just love that hymn and all that is conveyed in that wonderful song. So it's been great, and I reluctantly say goodbye, and some of you probably are heading back as well. Maybe not. Maybe a lot of you are residents here. I don't know, for the summer. But it's been certainly a privilege to speak for my family, my wife Cindy, myself, and the rest of my family. We appreciate the opportunity to be here. Have made some really good friends and some really good conversations. Let you know, when the speaker comes off the platform, sometimes you realize he's more blessed by the fact that you have conversation taking place and interaction. And I so appreciate everyone's encouragement to us. Well, we'd like to take a look at the next and the last, the final in our series. Of course, we've been looking at the promises of God. Let me just make sure this is working here. Doesn't seem to be going. There we go. And one of those great, wonderful promises that we have from God's Word is found in Jeremiah chapter 29. You know, I keep saying, well, this is a favorite verse of mine. That's a favorite verse. The whole Bible is a favorite verse, right? And but this is a tremendous verse when you think of the promises of God. Remember I said at the outset that every time you see where God says, "I will," that's a promise. He made that promise to Jacob when Jacob found the Lord there at Bethel. He says, surely God is in this place, and I knew it not. And notice he said God is. He was in this place. He is in this place. God is surely in this place. Amen. Even here at Ocean Grove. And God said to Jacob, he said, "I'm going to make a promise to you. I'll bring you back to this place." Now, Jacob was supposed to cooperate with God. We're supposed to cooperate with God. And sometimes we don't. We get distracted, and our focus gets hazed a little bit. And that's what happened with Jacob. And he made his money, and he built his family, and you don't see him really calling on the Lord until he has a crisis experience. And we look at that at Genesis chapter 32, when we realize God's purposes for Jacob as well as God's purposes for us. And so this verse right here is a great verse. "I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." Now the King James Version, interestingly, says, it's thoughts of peace and not of evil to give you an expected end. And it's the same concept. My wife reminded me that I don't use that verse when I'm going to visit somebody in a hospital to give you an expected end. She says, don't use that verse on that one. You know, we want to do a future and a hope. And that's exactly what God was trying to convey to the nation of Israel. And it's a tremendous promise from God's Word. So that's what we've been looking at all week long. And I understand these messages will be available, I think, in the bookstore, if I'm correct. So if you want to get those other messages, you can get that. But we're using this verse from 2 Peter, reminding us of the promises of God that are exceedingly great and precious promises. And as we've mentioned all throughout the week, Samuel didn't let any of those promises drop to the ground, not word, one word dropped to the ground, because not one of God's promises will drop to the ground or fail. And we read about that in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 56, and this a sense of Samuel not letting him drop as well from 1 Samuel chapter 3. And so the promises that God has to us is directly to us. We talked about that. His presence with me, his protection of me, his peace in me, his power through me, and it's his purposes for me in the life of Jacob that we looked at yesterday. So today we want to take a look at these two aspects. His plans toward me, just as we were considering there in Jeremiah chapter 29, and then his place above me. What is heaven like? Heaven is a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. I'm going to see my Savior's face. Heaven is a wonderful place. And we sing that, and certainly know that it's there for us. The Lord promised it. We've heard it again this morning. All these hymns, they're given out. leader doesn't realize some of the things I'm going to be saying, and it's just brought out beautifully. That's the Spirit of God working in His wonderful way, as He always does. And we're going to be looking at the idea of heaven. What does that mean? What does that constitute in the life of a believer? It should be the expectant hope of every single believer. It should guide and direct our steps on earth. And we need to keep those things in mind. And there's a great verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. It says, "Eye has not seen, neither has ear heard, what has entered or entered into the heart of man, the things that God has for those prepared for Him." But, you know what? It says in the next verse, and we take that verse and we say, well, glory to them, we don't understand what they're like. And I agree with that. But really, that's not what that verse says. Because in the very next verse, verse 10, it says, "But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit." So that verse is teaching us that we can have some insight into what is in store for the believer. This is the believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. What is waiting ahead for us? And that's what I want to take a look at this morning. It is planned toward me, and it is a place of God. And that's that great verse we want to use for this portion. Now, today, unlike the other days, I'm going to be having a number of different scriptures that we'll be looking at. And so I put them for your benefit, so there's not too much page turning going on up on the PowerPoint screen. So that'll help you hopefully. But if you want to turn pages, you feel free to do that. You know, we got to keep in mind that the Lord has in store for us life. It says, "In His favor is life." The discipline of the Lord is there. We read anger, we think, "No, is God peevish?" No, He's not at all. He's mad at sin. He doesn't like sin. And His anger is but for a moment. His discipline, His chastisement is just a moment for a moment. Those He loves, He chastises, just like a parent would a child. You know, a child going out in the street in the middle of a busy highway with a bicycle, you know, the person who doesn't care will just let that child go. But a parent has a love and care and safety in mind for that child, is going to do all they can do to take that child and teach them a lesson. You can't go out on a busy road. And it may look like the parent is angry and, you know, just not happy at all with the child, but the idea is to save that child's life. And God has that same thing in store for you and for me. He spanks us, if you will, because He wants us to have that peaceable fruit of righteousness, as it says in the book of James. And so He wants the best for us in that way. It doesn't mean that we're going to be financially prosperous and successful. Maybe that's going to happen in our lives, maybe not. The promises are not physical promises. God doesn't give physical promises to His people. He gives the spiritual promises to His people. And that's far greater. That's far greater riches than we could ever enjoy here on earth. And so the verse often comes out, where does our help come from? And you know, you can always tell, interesting, when somebody reads this passage in Psalm 121, oftentimes it's read this way. "I will look to the lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence comes my help." Now, is that the way you're supposed to read it?
No.
Not really. The way you're supposed to read it, it's the case of the emphasis being on the wrong syllable. You know, that's it. Yeah, "I will lift up my eyes into the hills, from whence comes my help." That's the question. It's not a declarative statement. It's a question. Here's the declarative. "My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth." The psalmist there is saying, "I will lift up my eyes beyond myself. I can't do things. I can't tackle life on my own. I need help from above. I need divine help. I will look lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help?" It comes beyond the hills. It comes from heaven, the throne room of heaven. And that ought to be the attitude of every single believer. I can't do it by myself. It's just like we looked at with Jehoshaphat, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. When he had all those enemies coming against him, he brought all the family together. He brought all the people together, his friends, the nation of Israel. They were all gathered together. They said, "Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We're waiting to see what you can do in this situation." And that needs to be our sentiment as well. Every single trial, every single difficulty, every single problem we go through, we say, "Lord, help me through." We don't know what to do. In my own wisdom, I think it's going to take care of the situation here. That may create a problem. I don't know the full picture of things. Only God does that. So, Lord, I cast myself upon you and I ask for your leading, your guidance, your direction. Because only you know what to do in this situation. So I trust that you go and work. work on our behalf. And that's what trust is. And that's the life of faith. In the book of Habakkuk, we read, the just shall live by their faith. Right? We read that in the Old Testament. And that's reiterated three times in the New Testament. That same phrase, the just shall live by their faith, in Habakkuk chapter 2. That's repeated in Romans chapter 1. The emphasis there is on the just. The just shall live by faith. Those who have made their relationship with, solidified their relationship with the Lord, know the Lord Jesus as Savior, the just shall live by faith. Book of Galatians is repeated again, and that's emphasizing living the Christian life. So the just shall live by faith. It's not a static faith. It's an active faith that we need to act upon in the lives of, in our personal lives, bringing the principles of faith in. And then in Hebrews chapter 11, it's reiterated again, the just shall live by faith. And that's the emphasis in the great faith chapter, chapter 11. And so that one little phrase in Habakkuk is repeated three different times in the New Testament with different emphasis each time it's reiterated. And so we are to take our problems, our cares, our concerns to the Lord. What does it say in 1 Peter chapter 5? It says, casting all your cares upon Him. For what reason? He cares for you. I know I'm speaking to a good audience here this morning. And He does. He cares for us. So that's the thing to keep in mind all along the way. It's a future and a hope. God has things in store for us. I'm not preaching the prosperity gospel here. I'm just preaching what the Word of God is saying. He gives us a future and a hope. When He was speaking with the nation of Israel, He was talking about their future. He's talking to you and to me. He's talking about our future as well. Well, what does our future entail? What does it mean? Does it mean a life without problems? Take a look at these words here. Or consider out of this example in Exodus chapter 15. That's where the nation of Israel came through the wilderness, and not long after they had come through the Red Sea, they experienced the bitter waters of Marah. In other words, they were on through the Red Sea. God had marvelously delivered the nation of Israel. Pharaoh and the Egyptian chariots were just right behind them. And they got them cornered at the Red Sea. Someone says that's really the origin of between the devil and the deep blue sea. I've heard that, you know. Well, this is the Red Sea, but I don't know how they got the blue sea in there. But they were chasing them. Pharaoh, who represents in that spiritual picture Satan, who wants to kind of come after the people that he lost in his kingdom, like the nation of Israel, he's going to make life difficult for them. So Pharaoh and the Egyptian chariots, they chased down the nation of Israel and they had them blocked. Now they were already a redeemed people, right? The Passover lamb had already been slain, the blood had already been applied, they were already a redeemed people. So the picture of them going through the Red Sea is not so much a picture of salvation, you know, their redemption, but a picture of how God was going to now work on behalf of His people. Something they had never experienced before. They're going to see how God, in a powerful way, will deliver His people, like you and like me. And so He got them up to the Red Sea, and of course the Red Sea parted. And you know the story, right? The Sunday school student was hearing the account of the Red Sea, and somebody said, well, you know, it's only 6 inches of water, that Reed Sea, it's really the Reed Sea, not the Red Sea, and that's how some people analyze it. Perfect timing, yeah, that's right. So, when that was explained to the class, and the child heard this, that it was only 6 inches of water, then he says, that's even a greater miracle. God drowned the Egyptians in 6 inches of water. God's powerful hand at work in our experience. And He brings us through this particular episode. You know, a huge event that takes place. I've had that in my own experience as a brand new Christian. Just at age 17, 18, some tremendous things happen. And they register with you. And you're singing the praises of the Lord. And then not long after that, you hit a wall. And that's what happened with the nation of Israel. They're in the wilderness now. They had just had this experience. They're singing, they're rejoicing. The chariots are floating or sunk or whatever happened at the Red Sea. Red Sea. And they come now to a place after 3 days in the direction and in the will of God. They're going along. God commanded them to go this way, and all of a sudden they don't have any water. And they are crying out, "Lord, you're going to cause us to die of thirst." And he takes them to the place called Marah. And when they went to go drink the waters of Marah, Exodus chapter 15, verses 22 through 27, it says the waters of Marah were bitter. First there was no water, and then they cry out to the Lord for having their thirst quenched, and he leads them to bitter waters. What is God doing here? And they were just singing the praises of the Lord, and now they're grumbling all of a sudden. Well, they have to learn the lessons again in the school of God, which is what we have to do as well. And that was the whole purpose of that sojourn from Egypt to Canaan, as we spoke about the other day. Well, what was the resolution to this whole problem? You remember the account? God said to Moses, take a tree and throw that tree into the water. And because that was done in obedience to the word of the Lord, those bitter waters remained sweet. Now, what is the picture there? There's always these pictures. Remember, I purposely put that slide up there. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11 says, all these things happened. They weren't myths. All these things happened for our examples, that we, through the admonition, the warning of the Scriptures, might have hope upon whom the ages have come. God has said there's a true account that took place, but it's got spiritual lessons to it. 1 Corinthians, New Testament, chapter 10 tells us that. And the wonderful picture, I think, that we see in that picture is all the events that we go through, the negative experiences and all the rest, when we apply the cross, the tree, the one that the Lord Jesus died upon, and put that into a situation, it can change the perspective of that situation around. I know the thoughts I have towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. I'm just letting you experience these things so that your love for me is far greater than your love for things. As great as this place is, as great as this town is, as great as this audience is, as great as the experiences of these activities, the singing, the hymns, the music, everything. Wonderful. But it shouldn't exceed the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He is our focus. He is the one that we're loving. Having not seen you love, it says in 1 Peter, we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. He is the focus of our attention. And all these things, as wonderful as they are, the memories, the experiences, are because of what He has accomplished, what He has done in our lives. And that's the thing to keep in mind. And so those bitter waters of Marah are a good experience. You know what happened? When they obeyed the Lord, it says God then brought them to an oasis where there are 70 palm trees. And it was a tremendous thing. That's verse 27 of that chapter, that portion. Obedience to the Lord, going through the Lord's disciplines, if you will. Not punishment. It wasn't punishment. They were led that way by God. God directly led them to a place where there's no water, and then bitter waters under God's direction. And then, after they obeyed and they submitted and yielded to the Lord, then He brought them to this oasis of 70 palm trees. What an experience they went through. Sometimes that's what happens to happen in our experience too. We're more in love with the Lord, and like it was with those disciples on the Sea of Galilee, Matthew chapter 14 that we looked at, they come through that experience and they have a deep devotional love for the Lord. Now we know truly you are the Son of God. They could have said that before at the very beginning of the trip, but now it has some weight to it and real experience as well. And so we always think that God's promises are all for us. We're going to have a great experience all the way through life. I heard a preacher one time say, most Christians, most believers think that God owes me a full, happy, fulfilled life with no problems. Okay, that's what the preacher was emphasizing to his audience. Don't take that position, but he wasn't saying that's what you should have. He was saying, warning that you shouldn't have that attitude. Annie Johnson Flint, some of you are familiar with her great poetry, what an insight this woman had. But she wrote a poem which I think is absolutely wonderful. God has not promised. Some of you, I'm sure, have heard of this poem. But listen to this. God has not promised. Sky is always blue. Flower-strewn pathways all our lives through. God has not promised. Sun without rain. Joy without sorrow. peace without payment. God has not promised that we should not toil, that we shall not know toil and temptation, trouble and woe. He has not told us we shall not bear many a burden, many a care, but, that's the transition, right? But God has promised strength for the day, rest for the labor, light for the way, grace for the trials, help from above, unfailing sympathy, undying love. That's what God has promised. The waters will seem to overflow, the flame will seem to burn, but, as we learned yesterday from the great hymn of Charles Wesley, the flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. And so God brings us through those valley experiences. We go through those things. The flame shall not hurt thee. If rivers will not overflow, it doesn't mean the flame's not there. It doesn't mean that the rivers aren't there. But God has promised to be with you through those experiences. And that's what that great hymn and poem of Jonathan Flint reminds us of. Turn your Bibles for just a moment to Psalm 84. It's time to open up. I don't want to ever come off the platform without saying turn your Bibles. Right? We want to look at the Word of God. The Word of God is living and powerful, and it speaks to the issues of the day. Psalm 84 is a great psalm. As you know, David wrote most of the psalms, but not all of them. There's 150 psalms, and he wrote most of them, but not all of them. And there's 12 of them that are ascribed to the sons of Korah. Now, Psalm 84 is one of those psalms of the sons of Korah. And before we start, who were the sons of Korah? Well, they were the descendants of a major rebellion that took place back in the book of Numbers. Korah and just a few people stirred up the people and got them speaking against Moses and Aaron. And after a while, it was one person, then it was four people, and then it was 250 people, and then it was the whole congregation spread like wildfire. And you count in Numbers there, chapter 14, verses afterwards, 16 in particular, and 17, talks about a great rebellion that took place, and as a result of all that, Korah and some of those troublemakers were swallowed up by earthquake. We heard an earthquake about it in the news, right? Things are really happening in our world today. Well, that was an earthquake then. Now, fast forward, generations later, the sons of Korah, the descendants of that rebel, come in there, and they are writing this psalm as a collective group. And they're walking with the Lord. So don't fear if your descendants were horse thieves, or whatever. It doesn't mean that you're destined to be a horse thief, okay, in your family tree. God's grace and mercy is there. The sons of Korah here are coming back from the Babylonian captivity. That's the context of this psalm, Psalm 84. And they're anticipating coming back to Jerusalem. And even though the temple was decimated by the Babylonians, they're coming back and they're looking forward to being there in active service for the Lord and enjoying the presence of the Lord through the things that He established. And that's what Psalm 84 is all about. And so we read in verse 1, as they are thinking of this, as they're traveling the route, don't forget, they're in the middle of the desert. They're coming back from Babylon, and they're not there yet. And they're saying, how amiable or how friendly is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts? Collectively, they're crying out, saying, my soul longs, yea, even faints for the courts of the Lord. They're not there yet, but they're going to be. He says, my heart, my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, a swallow, a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. They were even envious of the birds that were flying in the environs of the temple. And they said, oh, it's just so lovely. Interesting, they use a sparrow and a swallow. The sparrow is one of the least significant birds there are. Remember the Lord said, are not one sold for a farthing, you know, two, whatever. They're cheap, you know, not colorful, they're not fancy. People go out and buy sparrows to have in their homes. But they are homeowners, aren't they? And you think of somebody who has some sort of assets, is owning a home is one of those things. Even the sparrow has found a home, and a swallow a nest for herself. Why a swallow? Well, if you ever walk out into a field and you the sea, a swallow, they are ceaseless in their flying. They just fly and flutter all over the place. It seems like they never come to rest. That's a picture of the world at large. But the swallow finds a nest for herself where she may sit down and rest, even with her young, even your older, the Lord loves. A beautiful picture here. Somebody finding a home and finding rest in the things of the Lord. And the sons of Korah are thinking this through, and they're contemplating this in their anticipation as they make their journey to this destination. And they say, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They'll be still praising you. Selah. Just need to stop for a minute. Just think about that. Boss. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. They're just passing through. The rain, they pass through the valley of Baca, which is not actually a place. It's just a figurative place. The place of tears is what it means. Baca means tears. When they go through it, they make a well. They stop. They find some place of comfort there, and they make it a well for the next traveler that would come along and find refreshment. That's what that verse means. And it says, they go from strength to strength. Everyone appears before God in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, verse 8, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Selah. O God, behold our shield. Look upon the face of your anointed. A day in your courts is better than a thousand. Here is a great verse, right? I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in tents of wickedness. And I would absolutely say amen to that. With all the blessings that God has for his people. Greater than all the riches of Egypt and anything else. Moses gave those up. He said, rather than suffer affliction with Christ, the pleasures of sin for a season, and all the riches he had at his disposal, he turned his back on it. He says, I want the things of the Lord. And so this psalm finishes up. The Lord is God is a son of Sheol. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will leave the fold for those who walk uprightly. And in anticipation, these sons of Korah traveling through the desert wilderness are looking forward to the time where they can just be in the very presence of the Lord. Someone has subtitled this psalm, Psalm 84, being homesick for heaven. Homesick for heaven. Because it portrays the wonderful anticipation that God's people should have of being in the very presence of the Lord. We want to come together and meet together in fellowship with the Lord's people in a place like this. But how greater to realize that one day we will see the Lord Jesus Christ face to face. And we will be with those whom we loved and have loved for years and have gone on before there around the river of God. To be there in the very presence of the Lord with those who've gone before us. And even in the Old Testament, they spoke about being gathered to their fathers. You see that phrase used many times, they're gathered to their fathers. It means there's a population in heaven of people who are redeemed, who have gone before, thousands and millions, whatever, who have gone before. They're all in heaven. I heard the illustration from a message, recorded message from Dr. Donald Gray Barnhouse. Some of you hear that name? Ever hear that name? I'm sure some of this audience have. Great Bible teacher from Philadelphia. He said he'd drive through the town and see a big cemetery. He says, well, there's half the population of the town right there. And of course, they're dead. And the other group are living, right? And Paul would say the same thing. Ephesians 3, he says, I bow, for this reason I bow my knees to the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, to those who are in heaven and on earth, the family of God, the family that's in heaven and the family of God that's on earth. And so these are gone before. And if you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have said to him in your life, Lord, I can't do it. I need your help. I need your forgiveness of sins. I repent of my sins. God says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, just like that, you have salvation. That's a wonderful thing. You don't have to climb a mountain. You don't have to give thousands of money. The thief didn't get any money. He didn't have the opportunity to come down and get baptized. But the Lord said, you have this. The 11th hour decision. Don't wait for the 11th hour. Who knows if you'll even be alive and understanding things in that 11th hour. You may not have the capacity. So if the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart here this week, or even today, even right now, you settle that business with the Lord. And you say, Lord, I want you in my life. And when you have that instantly, like I mentioned on the first day, you're brought into all these spiritual benefits, like I had when I was at a position in that corporation. Explain the benefits. As soon as a person becomes an employee, they are filled with all the benefits of that retirement package and everything else. That's exactly what happens to the believers as well. And so Psalm 84 is a great psalm to contemplate, think through, meditate on, and realize all those blessings that are in store for us. There's another great portion in Genesis chapter 24. We won't need to turn to it right now. But if you were to compare Genesis 22 and 24, that in itself is a spiritual picture. We know this because it's referred to in the New Testament. But you know chapter 22. The great chapter there with Abraham and Isaac going together to the place of sacrifice. Picture of the Father and the Son going together. John chapter 5 says, "The Father works hitherto, and I work," the Lord said. The Father and the Son going together to the place of sacrifice, and Abraham and Isaac in Genesis 22, a spiritual picture there, of going to the place where the Son would lay down his life voluntarily. What a wonderful picture that is of the New Testament, the work of Christ. Of course, in that episode, the ram was caught in a thicket, and Isaac came up from the altar, but the picture is that he was resurrected. God gave him back again. Hebrews talks about that very thing that took place and the spiritual picture behind it. That's chapter 22. Chapter 23, Sarah dies and she's put away. She's put into a grave. And so then chapter 24, we see the picture of Abraham charging his eldest servant, probably Eleazar, but not named in that chapter for specific reasons. He's the unnamed servant. And he's charged with the responsibility to go out to a far country and find a bride for his son, the heir of all things, Isaac. Abraham's giving this servant the charge to go out there. Don't be distracted. Go right to it. Find a bride for my son Isaac, the heir of all things. And so he goes a great distance over this wilderness. He comes to the place. He finds this woman who comes, Rebecca, who comes to the well. And he had already been praying all along the way. It's a wonderful picture, too, of the servant of the Lord being obedient and doing just what the Lord tells him to do. Wonderful picture there. But even a greater picture is the Holy Spirit going out into the world and working in the hearts and consciences of men and women to draw them to understand the glories of Christ. And the unnamed servant took with him, it says, in verses 10 to 11, I think, of that chapter, it says, he took all his master's goods in his hand to explain and to show the blessings of the heir of all things, Isaac. And so through that demonstration and through his persuasion, he persuades Rebecca to come follow him to go back to the heir of all things, to become his bride. Beautiful spiritual picture of the work of the Holy Spirit in the world today. Lovingly wooing and drawing people to himself. That's the ministry of the Holy Spirit. John chapter 16, verses 8 through 11 says that he will convince the world of sin, their own sin, and the righteousness of Christ, the glories of Christ, and judgment, the judgment of Satan when he was judged at the cross. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is to help us understand those spiritual realities so that we're taken up with a person of Christ who said, I never saw that. As I open the page of the Scripture, as you open the page of the Scripture and talk to people, witness to people about the wonders and glories of Christ, that has a way of affecting the heart. And like Rebecca said, when her family was there, hey, let her stay here and decide on it for 10 days. Well, you know, we have family members that would love to pull us back and say, you don't get too spiritual. Don't get too serious about going to this church that you're talking about. Family members can never even be a distraction, can't they? But then they turn to Rebecca and says, you make the decision, put that decision squarely on her shoulders. And she said, wonderfully, I will go. Genesis 24. And she accompanies this unnamed servant all the way across the wilderness with the promise that one day she will see this heir of all things. That in itself is the picture of the Christian life. Holy Spirit working in our hearts, showing us and declaring the glories of Christ. Psalm 45 says it well. My heart is indicting a good matter. I speak of the things that's touching the kid. My pen is a, my tongue is a pen of a ready writer, ready to talk about the glories of the one who is the king. David wrote those words. It's the same application here to Genesis chapter 24. The unnamed servant, bring that person. What happens? They get closer and closer, and Isaac comes out from his house, and he meets his bride, Rebecca. We're waiting for the coming of the Lord. We're waiting for him to return. It's a beautiful picture of that, too. And all these things. And so she's traveling through the wilderness, having not seen him, though she loves him. And she rejoiced with joy unspeakable, full of glory, just like 1 Peter talks about. And so spiritual pictures all throughout the scriptures. And so this is what the believer should have too, the anticipation of being in the presence of the Lord, the presence of Christ, face to face with Christ, my Savior, face to face. What will it be? And so that's what 1 Peter 1:8 talks all about. John 14 tells us that the Lord Jesus spoke to his disciples there in the upper room. And he said, I will prepare a place for you. They're talking about the Lord's thoughts toward us, his sentiments toward us, as well as the place that he's prepared. So what is this place like? That's the question, right? What is this place like? Let's turn our Bibles as we finish up to Revelation chapter 21. Just turn for a moment to Revelation chapter 21. All the way, as you know, in the back of the book. Incidentally, it's not Revelations. It's Revelation. One Revelation. It's the revelation of Christ.
Amen.
It is what he reveals and holds out. The word apocalypse doesn't mean terror. It means the unveiling. That's really what it means. It's become to be known as destructive. That's part of what Revelation talks about, the destruction of sin. But it's really the unveiling. But it's also the revelation of who Christ is. And in the book of Revelation, there are seven different aspects of the character and person of Christ. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the bright morning star. You have seven different revelations of the character of Christ, as well as the revelation of Christ for the consummation of the age. And so it's an interesting study to take a look at. Well, Revelation chapter 21, John says it very clearly as he receives this revelation of Christ. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. Right off the bat, right here in verse 1, we're told it's the land of no more. Further along, look at it with me down in verse 4. God in this place will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There will be no more pain, for the former things have passed away.
Amen.
And so we call it the land of no more. Right? It's the land of no more. There's no more crying. There's no more tears. There's no more death. No more sorrow. No more pain. No more sea. What that is all about, I don't know. You look at the commentaries on that no more sea and you say, why? What's the significance of no more sea? Why is that? Ocean Grove. Oh no. What will happen there? No more sea. But some have said, well, maybe it has to do with Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. Not really too theological here, but maybe that's the area of chaos that took place in the creation account. So I look at it from that standpoint. There's a lot of different interpretations why there's no more sea. But either way, there's no more sea and no more of these things. The shadows will flee away. Song of Solomon says, the sighing ceases. All the tears, all the worries, all the cares, the things that rack our minds and our emotions and our sorrow, everything is all going to be gone. We know that heaven is a wonderful place, as we talked about, filled with glory and grace. But it says in the very next verse, verse 5, then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, John, write, these words are true and faithful. So what does he make new? Well, he makes a new home in us. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 talks about if this body is dissolved, we have one in heaven, eternal in the heavens. We have a brand new home waiting for us in Christ. The Lord Jesus promised this again in John chapter 14. He says, if it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. What does that place look like? Or Revelation chapter 22, we take it literally, or at the end of chapter 21, I'm sorry, the end of that chapter, talks about a city that has gates, verse 12, great high wall with 12 gates, 12 angels at the gates, names written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes, children of Israel. Verse 14, the wall of the city had 12 foundations, on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The big city. And it says in verse 16, the city is laid out as square, its length is as great as its breadth. We measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs, its length, breadth, and height are equal. So if you took that literally, that would be 1,400 miles tall, 1,400 miles out, 1,400 miles wide. Pretty big. A lot of people. Praise the Lord for all those who trusted Christ to save. That's very large. And this is where we have a place awaiting us. The promise of the Savior. A new home. And a new body. What does that mean? And people are speculating. What's going to happen when a believer dies? When the Lord said to the thief on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise, what would that mean later in the day? Where would he be? How would he be? And some have speculated that maybe, you know, we have a spirit. There's our spirit that goes up to be with the Lord, absent from the body, present with the Lord, our spirit with the Lord, awaiting a future day when the Lord would return. And it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, it says that the dead shall rise first. But how they rise first? They're given a resurrected body to rise and given new bodies at that point. So the question is, you know, this gets into the theological thing, but the question is, okay, what happens when we're, Lord, maybe we're just in spirit form and then resurrected and given a new body. And that body and spirit are then united at that point of Christ's return. So I viewed it from that way. There's other interpretations as well. But remember in John chapter 21, the Lord Jesus, post-resurrection appearance of Christ, he appears to the disciples and he's able to eat food, but then able to walk through walls and walk through doors. So that's interesting. Do we have a body like that? But then in 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, it says, behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, it's not yet revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Amen. So, maybe there's another aspect to the body that we have in heaven. Will we need sleep? Will we need to eat? We don't have to worry about sin anymore. Sin is banished. No more pain, no more sorrow. That's right. Hey. Sorrow is gone. And all of that, what will that be like? We don't know. All we can say is Paul, when he got caught up in the third heaven, but not seven heavens. There's the heaven right above us, the sky. There's the stars and the moon, and that's the second heaven. And the third heaven is the abode of God. There's only three heavens. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12, he says, I got caught up into the third heaven. And I heard things that were so joyful, I can't even utter them. So we know it's joy in the presence of the Lord. Psalm 16 says, I shall awake. 17 says, I will awake with thy likeness. The glories of heaven, all the sorrow, all the sin, all that put away. And the perspective, the things that make us sorrowful now, the hurtful memories, the whatever it was, whatever problems are plaguing you even perhaps today, we'll have a brand new perspective in heaven. What does the scripture say in 1 Corinthians chapter 13? For now we see in a mirror dimly, the word of God dimly, but then face to face, it will be clearly known to us. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even or just as I'm also known. That's what 1 Corinthians 13 talks about. So when we get to heaven, the secret things that were kept in the counsels of God here on earth that we don't know, there are things he keeps secret. Apparently they're revealed to us in heaven. Then shall we know, even as we're also known. That's in heaven.
Amen.
So that's a full knowledge of understanding of things. But what will it be then? You know, that's the testimony in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 right now, verse 12. But afterwards, when we're in the glory, this is what we could read 1 Corinthians 13, 12. For then we saw in a mirror, dimly. But now, face to face, that's a testimony in reverse. Then I knew in part, but now I know just as I'm also known. We had a full understanding and knowledge of eternal things and divine things. And so, what will we see in heaven? Hebrews 12, verses 22 through 24, identifies seven different things. Once again, there's seven things. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. This is what happens for the believers. They're caught up to be with the Lord in heaven. This is what they see, all these things. The third thing, to innumerable company of angels. We see angels there in heaven. Realize their ministry in our lives. And then it says to the General Assembly Church of the Firstborn who are registered in heaven. And to the God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, and then most importantly, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. Love and spring one speaks better things than that of Abel. To the Lord Jesus Christ. So just as we finish here, this is what we're told in Scriptures. In the Scripture, John chapter 5. Be patient, therefore, brethren, to the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman, the farmer, waits for the precious fruit of the earth. Just like a farmer waits for the fruit of the earth, so the Lord Jesus, our husbandman, is going to wait for us. He's patiently waiting for us until we receive the early and latter rain. The Lord Jesus in the upper room ministry said in John 17, verse 24, Father, this is his seventh prayer request in that chapter. Father, I will that they also whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world, the Lord Jesus said. And so every time a Christian passes from this scene, the Lord Jesus Christ's prayer is answered. That prayer in John 17, that they might behold my glory in heaven. And when I consider all these things, what do I say? All these things, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory we shall be revealed in us. That's what Romans 8:18 tells me. And so I hope that is a help and encouragement to you here today. The glories of heaven are waiting for us. And we'll say, indeed, it was worth it all when we see Jesus, right? It was worth it all. The rewards will be given out. The things that were done in secret that you thought no one appreciated, the Lord Jesus saw every one of those things done for his glory. And he'll reward you for it. So it'll be worth it all when we see Jesus. Life trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse of his dear face. All sorrow will erase. So bravely run the race until we see Christ. And that's what God wants for us as well. Let's close in a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, thank you again for the wonderful promises that are in your word, the exceedingly great and precious promises. And so we pray, our Father, that we might stand upon these promises, that we would indeed embrace them, be persuaded of them, like the heroes of the faith, and that we might not let one drop to the ground. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness, that every promise has come true, and not one of them will fail. And so we pray that you bless this company of your people today. Help us to act on these words for your honor, for your glory.